Ham Radio Now, episode 237. This is OpenWebRX, and it is presented by Andras Retzler, HA7ILM, from the Digital Communications Conference, ARRL and TAPR, back in 2015, October, in Chicago. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. I'm the guy that pushes all the buttons to put this stuff together. Andras is going to say there are lots of SDR receivers out there that you can reach with a browser. So, you know, why do another one? This is his deal. Well, what sets OpenWebRX apart is that you can put your own SDR receiver on the web and let other people use it. So that's what his thing is all about. So first, this quick pitch to click the pig and help me keep the programs coming. HamRadioNow.tv, you know the drill. And now Steve is going to try to calm Andras' nerves before he gives his talk.
Andras is a little nervous here, so we're going to make him feel right at home, aren't we all? So there, that was your calming moment. That was your zen moment, or us in electronics, we call that your zener moment. Okay. So I would very much like to introduce Andras, also from Hungary and Budapest. He's going to talk about his open source project that he did for the RTL dongle, and he calls it Open Web. And his call sign, Hotel Alpha 7, India Lima Mike. And take it away.
Okay. Hello. I'm going to talk about OpenWebRX, which is an SDR receiver software with a web user interface. And in fact, I started this project about 2 years ago when I was conducting courses and workshops on amateur radio to other university students like me at the AJ5 Kilofox Uniform Radio Club at the university's dorm. And I realized that I could make these people interested in amateur radio by talking about SDR. So there were some engineering students who already had a background in IT, and when they realized that they could buy a $15 USB dongle and that would open the world of radio frequency to them, so that's they find it really exciting. And it was quite straightforward that if we had a receiver available from the internet with only a web browser needed to use it, then it could bring even more people close to SDR, radio communications, and amateur radio. And that's not my idea. There are already existing solutions for that. For example, there is WebSDR, which you may already know. This is by Peter, PA3FWM. I think it's the best solution right now because it's it can so multiple users can connect to this server, and they can listen to different signals within the receiver bandwidth. It has also fancy features like an auto notch. You can also use it for mobile devices. The only drawback is that it's not open source, and you can't even easily get the binaries because you have to ask the author of the software directly. He may send you the program by email or something. So, okay. There is another similar software called Shiny SDR by Kevin. His call sign, I think, is AG6YO. This one is more suitable for use as a private remote receiver because it has controls for example, changing the center frequency that is not good at the public receiver. And if multiple clients connect, then they will have to listen to the same demodulators right now. But Kevin has promised that he will add better multi-user support later. So we'll see Okay, in fact, when I started my own project, then it was not available yet. So, that's how OpenWebRX looks like. That's the web user interface. And I also want to show some demos on it. So it's a server software like the other two. You can set it up on your own server, and you can share your SDR receiver with it to the internet. And okay, let's see on the first video, we are just listening to an narrowband FM transmission. We can click on the spectrum on the waterfall display to select the signal, and then okay. Another example. This is a receiver in Netherlands operated by Bart PA3HEA. Okay. This video I wanted to show that we can demodulate CW. We can also set the filter bandwidth and change it. Okay. We can also move the filter shape like the baseband shift knob would do on a real radio if we hold down the shift key. So it works quite similar to WebSDR. And in fact, multiple users can connect and listen to different signals just like in WebSDR. As you see, there are also the different modulations, so all the modulations that are available on a usual rig, okay. And we can also zoom into the waterfall display, and we'll see that, just a moment. Yes, and we can also pan the waterfall display by dragging it, and I also wanted to show that we can go back in time on the waterfall display by dragging the scrubber on the right. And okay, maybe you have noticed that there are some status information on the left, and the network usage is quite low. That's because there is ADPCM compression used. I will talk about that later. And I also have a website where the publicly available receivers are listed. There are not much receivers yet right now, but I hope that this would be a global network of SDR receivers later. Anyone who does a free registration on this website can add his own receiver to the list, and it will only list it if it is active. Okay. And I also wanted to show in this screenshot my receiver was on my software was used at another radio club at our university, and it's just receiving FO29 satellite, and you can also see the slant lines that show the Doppler effect, and there was also a live image of the antenna array that was pointing to the satellite. In fact, it's the same. It was installed at the same radio club that was involved in the first Hungarian CubeSat. Now it was just listening to FO29 in the screenshot. Okay. Now, how to set up your own server? I want to talk about this because it's quite easy to do. What you need, first of all, you need an SDR hardware. Of course, I only support R2SDR right now because that's the one I have at home. But I've seen people using this software with USRP2. The author of the AFEDRI SDR, Alex 4Z5LV, I think, he has made a modification to OpenWebRX so that it could be used with his own hardware. There is also support for sound card-based SDRs in code, but I hadn't had the chance to try it yet. And in fact, it's only two lines of code in the config file. You can use any kind of SDR hardware that has a command line tool for Linux that can output the IQ samples to the standard output. So I think it's easy to add support for others. Okay. Of course, you need a server. As a server, you can use a desktop PC or a single board computer. You know, now Raspberry Pi is quite popular. You can use a Raspberry Pi 2 to run OpenWebRX. You can also use an Android C1 as well. Or I think you can use others, but that's the two I've tested. And well, you can't expect the same computing performance from Raspberry Pi 2 as you would do from server with an Intel i7 or something. So that means that you have to find a compromise between the maximum number of clients you allow to connect simultaneously and the receiver bandwidth. Because we talk about a multi-user SDR software here, and the CPU time required to process a second of IQ data, so that gets multiplied by the number of clients, and also also increases if we use higher bandwidth. Higher sampling rate at the receiver. So there are settings in the config files for setting these values correctly. But I can, as far as I remember from my tests, I could have about 10 clients simultaneously at 250 kilosamples of IQ source on the Raspberry Pi 2. And I could have 10 clients with 2 megasamples of IQ source on an i7. So that's the difference between the two. Okay, but you can also run a Raspberry Pi, and this will be enough for some car-based SDRs as well, I think. Okay. And also, it's not hard to set it up. You will need a Linux box. You will have to clone to Git repositories and build a DSP library. I will also talk about later, or the DSP tool. Edit the config file, and you can run OpenWebRX. Okay, and regarding the clients, we can use the Firefox or Google Chrome. At the clients, Internet Explorer is not supported, and you will also be able to open OpenWebRX web page from Google Chrome for Android, but it will not be as good. I will have to do some more optimizations to get it better on mobile devices like that. But anyway, it is somewhat usable right now as well. Okay. Yeah, I wanted to talk about some more interesting technical details about the implementation. But first, I want to tell you a story. When one of the workshops I had about a year ago, I was talking to some other fellow guys at the radio club on the basics of SDR, so how to process radio signals on a computer in a nutshell, what does an AD converter do, also about some basic modulations, analog modulations, some digital modulations, and I also gave them an environment to test their knowledge out, and that consisted of a computer and an RTL SDR, and I gave them about 15 lines of C code and told them that they should expand it. They only have to edit that one line that's in green right there. If you look at it, it just takes so a pair of samples, IQ samples from the standard input, and writes a real sample to the standard output, and those remembers the last two samples. I told them they could make working FM receiver out of it if they enter that line correctly, and then they could hear some dance music if they did it well, and they could figure it out with my help. So this is a working solution for that. In fact, if you look at it more thoroughly, it just didn't normalize the phase and things like that, but it just works. I felt that it's like building a crystal radio set, but for SDR, because this is just a similar easy job if someone knows C. And I could also show them another formula for doing the same. It's called the quadricorrelator. And okay, I showed it to multiple people, and once a girl said, "Wow, those numbers are coming in and music is coming out." And then I felt that she could understand what is DSP. So that's why I made the whole thing. I'm just showing you that because that was behind this concept. It's similar to what I'm going to do at the CSDR2 I'm showing later. So I could run this by entering one line of code into the Linux terminal. The first part, so we use the RTL SDR tool here to take the IQ samples, then compile and run this demodulator to do actual FM demodulation, run the decimation with the following command, and then we just open the samples to the sound card. And that was the point where I realized that I could make a command line tool that could be used for building communication receivers or ham radio receivers easily. And if you want to try this code, then you will find it on GitHub. But I just want to talk about the CSDR tool that's behind OpenWebRX. It also has a library that it links to. It's called libcsdr. I'm talking about this because along with using it within OpenWebRX, I think someone could use this to build a headless ham receiver or something on embedded systems. So let's see another example on using this. We just take the IQ signal from the HRN-SDR tool again. Then we use CSDR to convert it from unsigned 8-bit to floating point. Other functions of CSDR work on floating point signals. Let's say we want to receive a narrowband FM transmission, something similar that I've already shown in the first video. And we just want to shift that signal to the center of the spectrum. So we can do it by this command. And we can also decimate the signal to match the sampling rate of the sound card, and do FM demodulation as well, limit the signal, run down phases, run AGC, and convert it back to integer. And now it can be used to output it to the sound card. And we can also listen to this working in this video. Yeah, I just pasted the same command. Sorry for noise.
AJ7 India Lima Mike testing CSDR.
Okay, I just used my handheld radio. So what are the advantages of this whole thing? Many SDR software that are available for ham use just use GNU radio, and it is quite sometimes quite hard to build. It takes a lot of disk space. And so CSDR only contains those functions that are required to build a communications receiver. You can't just, an analog communications receiver. You can't use it to demodulate OFDM or something that you would be able to do with GN radio. In fact, you can do anything with GN radio to your signal. So it's not intended to be something like that, but it's smaller. It just it also takes only 40 seconds to compile on a Raspberry Pi 2 instead of the several hours or so. This approach that we use we start multiple processes and use the OS pipes between them for communication allows us using multiple CPU cores, and I think it was the one of the easiest ways of coding this or implement this. In fact, the first time I've tried this, I was sure that it won't work because there will be lags or something. I also know that scheduling is very important in a data flow system. This is also a data flow system. But I realized that that I could get it working. I could use it in OpenWebRX. So I think it's a proper solution for this problem. In fact, it's quite hard to decrease the lag between the delay between the beginning and the end of the chain. I'm working quite hard to do that and to get lower response times in OpenWebRX. But anyway, it just can be used at this point as well. Okay, then let's see. I just wanted to show you a similar flow graph in GNU Radio that just does the same as the one command I entered for doing FM demodulation with CSDR. Okay, and this is the terminal output of OpenWebRX, and you see that it uses CSDR internally, and this approach of having different processes to do different tasks is always good that we can just look at top and see which process takes up the most CPU time so that we can optimize it. And when multiple users connect, then we see a lot of the same process. This also means that if we optimize just one function, that will have a lot of impact. We'll be able to get more users to connect simultaneously without lags. And let's see how we can do acceleration in an SDR system. So there are multiple common ways of doing that nowadays. One is using the synchronous instruction multiple data extensions to the CPU's instruction set. That's what I used, and I will also show you. That means that we used to have, for example, an instruction to add two floating point numbers in two registers. And store the result in a third register. Now we have instructions for adding a quad register of four floating point numbers to another quad register of other four floating point numbers and store that in the third quad register, so just doing the whole thing parallelly. And so that's a way of acceleration, and it's already in the CPUs now. Okay. Another way of accelerating is using those graphics cards that teenagers used to buy to play FPS games. And in fact, these are quite good at general purpose processing of signals as well. And a third way of acceleration is using FPGA for high performance computing tasks. I wanted to mention that there is a version of OpenWebRX that John Simmons that did a custom FPGA-based radio, and he used OpenWebRX for the UI, and this is a full edge of receiver, just like the wideband WebSDR. But it's under testing right now. I think it works best on the lower frequencies, so he will have to improve it later. But he's working on it. So we also have an application for FPGA, and that's also open source. What about single instruction multiple data? There are the SSE instruction set extensions available for AMD and Intel CPUs widely. The other is the Neon, which is for ARM CPUs. For example, Raspberry Pi 2 has this extension set as well. How do we use this from the code? We can try to get the compiler to unroll our loops, but it will not be perfect, or it won't be the fastest solution because the compiler is not very clever at this at the moment. Another thing we can do is to use some functions that are extensions for C that will compile to these SIM instructions, and we can also manually do apps assembly optimization. This is the function that we've seen a few slides ago, that took so much CPU time to run, it works on the original sampling rate. For example, if we set it to 2 megasamples at a receiver, then its input will be 2 megasamples, and this will decimate it down to somewhere around 10 kilosamples, I think. So that takes a lot of time to do. What can we do to improve it? We can just use inline assembly and use these Neon instructions to speed things up. As a result, we'll see that there is about 300% improvement in speed. That now we only use 6% of a single core's CPU time with the same settings. So that we can let more users to connect to the same receiver as before. Okay. I wanted to talk about another thing I've made. This is the ADPCM. We want the least bandwidth between the server and the client. It's good for both the server and both the client. In fact, if we want to use OpenWebRX for example, in a home ADSL connection, so there's not much uplink available. So we have to do something about this. Because just transmitting raw samples on the network is not as good. One problem is that on the server side, we have these DSP functions for these tasks, so downsampling and ADPCM compression in the C language. But at the client, we have a frontend written in JavaScript. What can we do to make the work or the already existing code base work at JavaScript? In fact, JavaScript is now not that slow scripting language or slow interpreted language it used to be in the in the 90s, because now all the browsers have just-in-time compilers built in, which means that every time you open a web page and it contains JavaScript, it will just compile the JavaScript to the native machine language of that architecture, and thus it can speed it up quite much. And in fact, Mozilla has made a subset of JavaScript called ASM.js, which is a subset that so if you use that, then or only that, then the just-in-time compiler can be used to optimize even more. And they claim that it's just it now comparing the native implementation and the JavaScript implementation, it's about so 2 to 1.6 times slower. So the JavaScript is 2 to 1.6 times slower than the native implementation, which is quite good compared to what it used to be. And they also made a compiler called mscripten, which is a source-to-source compiler, and it can be used to compile from C to JavaScript or to ASM.js subset of JavaScript. And big companies are using that right now to compile 3D games to the web, to WebGL or things like that. So that's it. I use this mscripten compiler to compile my my already existing DSP library to JavaScript and called it sdr.js. Well, in fact, it's not. This one is not too developer friendly right now. I had to write a lot of wrappers to use these functions. Now I have wrappers for the resampler and the ADPCM. So I can use these from OpenWebRX. And this is also. If you want to compile sdr.js, then you can from the CSDR repo. So you can do it with make MCC or something like that. That's in the README. And so with this approach, I could achieve that low network usage. So it was the original. We needed about. Sometimes about 2 megabits, and now we only need 100 kilobits per second to 200 kilobits. It also depends on the waterfall diagram settings. And just another last crazy idea, because I was thinking about how to compress the waterfall diagram, and. I already knew that the audio signal is, of course, a one-dimensional vector of samples, but realized that the waterfall is a continuously growing image, so it just can be used. So it can be compressed the same way as we would do on a photo, because we always send out only one line, so line by line, after each other, and you just can't run JPEG or PNG or something like that on one line of image effectively. I don't think that would help. These algorithms work with matrices and things like that on two-dimensional arrays. So I was thinking whether as we always send one line after each other, and that line is one-dimensional vector of dB values. What if we just compress that with ADPCM2? And that worked. So I'm using this in OpenWebRX. And okay, that's all I wanted to say about OpenWebRX. Right, I also written my bachelor's thesis on this topic that has some illustrations on how these algorithms work and things like that. I hope maybe someone else will be able to write his own SDR receiver if he reads this work, and of course others. Okay, and yeah, I would like to say a big thanks to two of my really good friends who helped me with the DSP algorithms and things like that. And if you want to look into this topic more thoroughly, then you could check it on my webpage over here. And are there any questions?
Steve Hickson, 5AC. Not so much a question, but I know you're looking for getting more horsepower, and there's going to be a BeagleBone X15 that comes out. I don't know if you've heard about this, but it has two-arm A15 64-bit processors, dual-core, but it also has two of the TI C66X DSPs on it, and we use those in our radio. We use a 67.4X, but we get 3 to 10 to 1 kind of performance improvement by using a DSP. Oh. So it takes a little bit of effort to optimize the stuff for the DSP, but it's well worth it.
Okay, thanks for mentioning that. Yeah, that's one thing I want to say that so this code runs on the Raspberry Pi 2, but Raspberry Pi 1 is not powerful enough to run it well. So yeah, I'm just looking into more acceleration. I'm happy to hear about any kind of new hardware that can help with it. Okay.
Very impressed with what you've done.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
One over here.
Good. On the.
Hi there, Frank, NQ8N. When you had that drawing up there with the JavaScript calling into the C DSP library, how do you make that connection? I know you mentioned the fact that you can compile the C code, cross-compile that into Java, but then or into JavaScript. But I thought originally you were running it without doing that. Did I get that wrong?
On the server, this runs compiled from the C code to native code. It is a shared object, as you can see, the libcsdr.so. But I'm using this through the CSDR tool. So that's just a Linux command, or that's just a command that you can start and starts out as a process within the operating system. But the other thing, when I just compiled this with MScript into a JavaScript file, I had to include it in the web page, and it had some functions that I could call. I had to write quite large wrappers to use it because the code compiled by MScript is just a bit strange, and it you have to look a lot into the documentation to be able to actually use it. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I guess so. If you don't do the cross compilation, it was just how does the JavaScript on the page talk to the other DSP functions? Through Ethernet or network pipes kind of thing, or
I use WebSocket and
WebSockets. That's it.
Yeah.
That's what I was asking. I wasn't sure exactly how that piece was connected. Thank you.
Okay.
Any other questions? We got one over here.
So the RTL SDR that you're using for receiving, the IQ data comes in through standard in, is that correct? Or are you interfacing directly to the USB?
I'm using the RTL SDR tool. So OpenWebRX is written in Python. That's a Python script that just sets up the HTTP server and things like that, and starts these CSDR processes, and also starts a process of RTL SDR, and then reads the I think that pipes it to Netcat, and there is another process that distributes the IQ data between the other processes. So it's quite hacky, but it works.
But it should be relatively easy to connect any receiver that generates IQ data.
Yeah, you can use, for example, the OZ player if you want to kind of interface it to the sound card. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
And then thank you very much.
Yeah, kids these days. You got to watch them every minute or they start writing software and inventing stuff. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Arvin is sitting back there waiting for you to stop by hamradionow.tv. Click on his icon. Help us out with a financial contribution. Thanks very much for those who have already done that. And I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. More coming. Over and out.